a lot of people of Indo-Dutch and Indonesian origin experienced racism in the Netherlands, like for instance my parents as well. They were denied entrance in clubs and discotheques. They were hit in the streets, for instance. They couldn't get a job or a proper job. They were denied promotions in companies. So a lot of my relatives and a lot of other people of Indo and Indonesian origin, they have experienced racism, but they didn't talk about it. And in for instance, among the Indonesian and Indo-Dutch communities, there's this, I wouldn't say philosophy, but it's sudah latmar, leave it be, it's in the past, move forward. That was their way, that was their coping strategy, which in hindsight was a bad strategy, at least for their children, for us. Obviously, it was not their intention to make it difficult for us, but they have made it difficult, more difficult for us, because they didn't talk about racism. They didn't want to be seen. They didn't want to be considered as being difficult, mm-hmm. as not non-ideal foreigners, so to say.
Like hitting people or calling people names, a lot of people will recognize that, but a lot of people won't recognize. Microaggressions, tokenism, micromanagement, bullying away, wanting you to create an inclusive environment for the picture, but not creating a safe place for you to work. And that's my specialty, the gaslighting that comes with racism.
Talking about safe space, because safe space is something I know you guys will find really important. What is it that a safe space is so hard to accomplish?
It's hard to accomplish because people don't acknowledge their own privileges and their own blind spots. They think, oh, I can do this. And that's also a form of white privilege, that you're entitled to everything. Instead of acknowledging that sometimes somebody else's voice needs to be centered. And it's not just about you. It's also a form of dehumanization and not seeing people from several backgrounds as human beings, and just not a walking, talking ethnicity, but a full potential human being.
When are you a full human being?
We're seen as a full human being that you can acknowledge that we're different, and that how we walk to society, we have different experiences, but you can still see me as Sarita, the one with the flashy blouse, mm-hmm. and the big earrings, you know, but also...
Looking lovely.
I know. I cannot overdress this time. I'm on stage. But it's also about your personality, your humor, your talents, your visions. It's not just a walking, talking ethnicity, but it's part of who you are. It's not your whole definition. That's humanizing connections and seeing somebody else as a human being.
This sounds pretty simple. Is actually simple, but it doesn't happen. And that's why I really like the documentaries, because the documentaries, they really center the people and their experiences, and these are actually experiences that haven't been centered in Dutch media and culture up till now, so to say. So it's really important that these stories are being told, but also that we listen to these stories, and that's difficult.
To listen, just how do we learn to listen?
Yeah, just shut up. Yeah, the thing is that when you're privileged, and I love this quote. The quote is called, "Racism, it's not the shark, it's the water." It's a deep one, right? It's not the shark, it's the water, because it's everywhere. It's institutionalized, and the thing is that when you're privileged, you think you're entitled to every story. Like, for instance, the demonstrations against racism, I'm certainly not impressed by that at all. because I know a lot of people who are very racist walk around with these demonstrations thinking they're not racist, but they can't keep people of color in their own organization because they bully them away. They're micromanaging them, they're microaggressions everywhere. What's your question again?
How do we listen?
Yeah, just shut up. And acknowledge that you're privileged and that you need to create room for others. It's also, you know, I love documentaries. Also, it was, Nick, your documentary for me was pretty triggering. Because this is really how things happen. And that's triggering to see as a woman of color, to experience this, but also how they get away with it and how underneath the skin it is. But also there is a lot of, you know, white privilege and white passive privilege when making documentaries. And I also know that. So, you know, acknowledge that too, because a lot of people of color are actually bullied away. They don't get funding, they don't get the same opportunities as white documentary makers in the industry. So it's often difficult also just to hear our voices and being centered.
Honky Punky Shanghai, Honky Punky Shanghai, Honky Punky, Honky Punky, Honky Punky Shanghai.
Hey, konnichiwa, hey!
Konnichiwa!
Chinezen, fucking coronavirus, fucking kut Chinezen. Hey, ik heb het over jou, hè? Ja, jij, ja, poep Chinees, joh. Hey! Flik nou eens op, joh! Flik nou eens op! Flik nou eens op, joh!
We make sure that what we're trying to do here grows.
It comes back to make sure to listen. I think that's that has been said before, but that's the main thing. And I think just as well, you know, that there's a lot of things you can say about this. For example, Sarita addressed tokenism. I think that's also one of the things that should be really looked at. You know, I've heard so many people saying that I cannot be racist because of the fact that I have a friend from Suriname, or I have a friend who is Indonesian, or you know, whatever, and that doesn't make you necessarily, like, you know, it's more than that. So it's layered, and I think that
they're often seen as diversity experts as well.
Yes,
but they're not.
It's true. So I hear what you say about the demonstrations as well, because that's a very good example. And I was there. I was including it in the documentary, and it was nice to see so many people fighting for the same cause, but. At some point you feel like, are you always fighting all the time? And you should. So getting back to your question, to pay it forward, yeah, just make sure that you address the problem, but don't get finger pointing all the time, because you may turn into the, yeah, how do you say it, like the mood killer all the time, but do it gently.
As my colleague, my friend, my family member, but I addressed your behavior. And that's very different than addressing a human being who's also learning. And even Malcolm X said, like, don't judge somebody for what they don't know, because there was a time that you did not know as well.
So what should we do next? Because we all here want to move forward. We want to, like how do you say that? That there's less racism, because it's so institutionalized that it's not something that's be gone in a second. What kind of things should we do more?
Well, first of all, speak out and create awareness of what actually is going on and what racism actually is. Because so many people still don't understand. They think, well, you call somebody this and I call you that, so but we're even. They don't see the power structures that are racism. It's really about acknowledging that there is, but also that we're not the definition of difference. There's so much more that holds us together as human beings. We're different, but we're not the definition of that difference. But listen, and also, privilege is about acknowledging and giving other people room to be, and not taking their voices and centering yourself again about how good you understand it right now. And that's also something that needs to change.
Yeah.
first thing, well, what I always say is, when we look at our television landscape in the Netherlands, for instance, we need to get rid of all the people that have been in charge for the past 20, 30 years. That's the first thing.
Yes.
I agree.
And especially when we talk about our public broadcasting system, we have a really unique system compared to other countries, and we should be proud of it. But it's also really perverse, yeah, but also corrupt, in the sense that the people that are in charge, the gatekeepers, the genre managers, the net managers, they will be in charge till they retire. Because that's the system in the Netherlands, you know? And that's the difference with, for instance, our commercial system. They will be fired when the ratings drop. We need to fire people in Hilversum.
So, broadcasters, should we stop with having public broadcasters then?
No, not at all. No. I'm all in favor of a public broadcasting system, but it should be a fair one. And the thing with our broadcast system is that they have these 7 or 8 criteria they use to measure the productive, the quality of the programs. One of the criteria is actually, so they have, it should be neutral, it should be independent, and one of the criteria is actually diversity. The program should be diverse. use this criteria to measure the success or the quality of the program.
It's funny though, because actually it's a law. It's the media law, which actually says that each broadcast needs to be pluriform or have a diverse sound. They believe, at least the broadcasts believe, that they are. Whereas we, from the outside, say we are not represented.
No. They don't. No. I, it should be nuanced. They don't. They say they are, but they don't believe they are. They know they are not. That's the thing. Because every year they need to evaluate the programming, and every year the result is that their programming is not diverse enough. But there are no consequences. You know,
they don't get fined because it's not commercial. You can't get. It's not.
There are no consequences, and they're not even like when you compare it to the BBC, for instance. The BBC is really detailed in what kind of diversity they want to achieve in a 5-year period, what the numbers should be, and if they don't reach their goals. Then they will tell why not, and they will tell the public what they are going to do to change it. And actually, last year, they committed to £100 million pounds to invest in more diverse programming. We're not doing it in the Netherlands.
And the thing is that a lot of people just. You know, I trained over 15,000 people already. And the thing is that a lot of, when a white organization asks me, a lot of time they want change immediately. They don't understand that the Netherlands has been colonizing for over 400 years and it has a sort of racist system with it. But when people of color ask me to train, they just ask me to create some awareness and some social cohesion. They are more realistic with what can happen during a period of time. It's not, you know, a realistic vision on what inclusion is.
There is not a quick fix.
There is not a quick fix. And again, there is not a quick fix.